back to our channel. Whoa, it's been a while. But we're going to figure out, we're trying to figure out our oratory skills.
Yeah, that's called the lion's roar.
It's something all great orators do. It is the way of things.
It is the way of things.
Yep. No, we're just, we're trying something out. Let us know if you like it.
No.
But, no, we're doing another wonderful review, or more correctly, discussion.
Yep.
And, we're going back to another important movie for me. I'm not sure about you.
Mm.
We're going to be talking about a little movie that could.
Yeah.
It was how the creator put it, you don't make feature films out of canceled TV shows.
Mm-hmm.
And today we're going to be talking about a movie called Serenity.
Mm.
It's the film adaptation and sequel slash closure project from the TV show Firefly.
Mm. Yeah, if you remember that.
If you remember that, oh so many moons ago. It was a little-known show, not very well-respected, but it's been gaining steam on the cult scene for a long time.
Yeah, you know, it's, even just a few years ago, it was kind of a big deal. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the show, when it was on television, didn't even make it a full season.
No, it only made it to 11 episodes with two unaired.
Mm-hmm.
And it just didn't catch on as well as it probably should have.
Well, I don't know. It's kind of a tough thing to sell space cowboys.
Yeah, space cowboys.
Which is basically what it is, you know.
Yeah, and what I like is the movie can stand alone on its own. You don't need to really know too much about the show.
Mm-hmm.
If you watch the show, it enriches the movie experience a little bit.
Yeah, a little.
But no, you can watch this without any prior information.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the simple part of it. It's just a fun movie. So, Al, run down the plot just a little bit.
Well, basically, something happens somewhere, and that's what this movie is about.
I couldn't say it any better, but, no, we alluded to space cowboys. What happens is this is a science fiction picture, which is set in a galaxy far after we've left the solar system in search of a new home.
Mm-hmm.
And there's all sorts of changes the planet system we land in. We're colonizing new planets, we're terraforming planets, and the government's running amok. Or maybe not running amok.
No, everyone else is running amok.
Everyone's just running amok, because it's human nature.
Mm.
And it leads to conflict. And out of this conflict between government and independent supporters is a starship called Serenity.
Mm-hmm.
Captained by a former veteran of the losing side of a war, who's just trying to make his way in the world today, and it's taking everything he's got.
That sounds like a... Oh, that's Cheers! I was thinking about the MC Hammer song, "You've got to pray just to make it today."
You know? I'm not as hip as you. I go for the Cheers theme song.
Yeah.
A little fish.
I like my bar music, my saloon music.
Saloon music.
Making your way in the world today. I don't know why we're singing that.
Yeah,
I'm singing that.
But,
where are we?
We're talking about Captain Malcolm Reynolds.
Mm.
And his attempts to still carve out a life for himself after the war. And his run-ins with the law, because he's a well-known smuggler. He's a well-known
thief. Basically Han Solo.
Yeah, he's like Han Solo with a cowboy touch to him.
Mm.
And without the 7-foot-tall walking carpet beside him. But what he's got is kind of a ragtag family.
Yeah.
People he's picked up along the way, war buddies, their relationships, friends, stowaways.
People with skills that are handy on the trail, so it were.
And so this crew finds themselves entangled in a plot, not so much a plot, but a situation where one of their crew members has a lot of information that the government wants to keep hush-hush.
Yep. And being a bunch of rascals, they say, nope, we're going to tell everyone about it. And
we're going to tell everyone, and we're going to keep this girl away from you, because even though we badmouth her at every turn, she's family.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the essence of the whole movie, is people making hard decisions with things and the results of said decisions from the show and also in the movie, too. Mm-hmm. So, But the one thing I like is movies like this really promote discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And we alluded to it in an earlier video. We were talking about living on the side of order and law, and then being the dissenting element,
mm-hmm.
actively. And whether or not we could live that lifestyle and questions like that. But this movie really puts a cap on that. It's it raises some good questions. And I know Al has been cultivating this attitude, which I don't disagree with. But it flies in the face of what most fans of this series and this movie would consider... I guess
you're not supposed to think that way.
No,
they're playing the role of the Alliance in this movie to me.
Yeah, you're the brown coat.
I'm the brown coat right now. I'm for the Alliance in this.
Yeah, you fly in the face of the fandom,
yep.
And that's not a good thing if you bring that up to some people. Like having your own thought process and the way you think about this. No, you're not supposed to do that. Who are you?
What do we have to do? Give the main character a pet dog?
Oh, that's the next logical step, is give him a pet that can die. There's some wonderful, wonderful characters in the movie that they introduced just for this film. And it's played by Chiwetel Ejiofor.
Mm-hmm.
And he plays the operative,
mm-hmm.
the foil to Malcolm Reynolds.
Mm-hmm. The true believer, the assassin.
Yeah, the assassin, the guy who understands what he's doing completely.
Yep.
And... That was a very strange take on a villain for the time. Like, usually, you know, in shows like this and science fiction and fantasy in general, the villain is somebody that really believes they're evil.
That they shouldn't. Like, okay, you know, they always say, like, in when you're writing a character for anything, it's like the villain never believes they're evil. Well, this guy's a little bit different. He knows exactly what he's doing, and he admits it's evil, and he admits that in the new galaxy, I guess, the Alliance is trying to create, there's no place for him, because he's a monster, by his own admission.
Yeah, but, and it's one of those lines, and the way he delivers it, there's nothing you can say to that. Like, you want to have some witty comeback to this guy, but he says, listen, you've got me. I am the worst of this whole organization.
Mm-hmm.
And I know this. You can't do anything to me except to fight me.
Yep.
Or let me finish what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a ultimate villain in my mind. One of my favorites.
Yeah. It's like Inara says, you know, he's a devout believer and what he's doing is correct. And, you know, belief is kind of an important theme. Like he kind of likes to, when him and Mal are going head to head, you know, he'll always ask, well, okay, do you truly believe what you're doing is right? And are you willing to die for that belief? And, you know, when Mal says, I am, he's like, good.
Okay.
And they get together and
yeah, the fight hits that next level.
Yeah, that's what I love about this movie is there's two of the great fight scenes in recent years, maybe ever, in movies for me.
What I like is they're very intimate. Like they're not
yeah.
overly trained and practiced things. They look really more like real fights.
Mm-hmm.
And they're tooth and nail affairs that they're doing anything possible to get an edge.
Yeah, it's like the agent will pull out a katana and Mal will pull out a screwdriver.
Yeah, it's all he could find.
It's all he could find. But there's still that serious look on the agent's face. Like, okay, I know it's not really a weapon, but I'm still gonna watch out.
Yeah,
you know, because this is tooth and nail, like you say.
Yeah, and this guy is no slouch. Like Mal's a fighter.
Uh-huh.
Maybe not as technically trained, but mm-hmm. he's been through the war. You know, he's mm-hmm. he's seen some stuff. And that's the one thing it seems to be in this movie is what the Alliance is doing to Malcolm Reynolds is reminding him of the worst side of him over the course of his journey in this film. And he hits that point when he says, are you willing to go that far to do something? And yes. So, you know, he's literally almost asking Mal to do these things to him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's strange. I don't know if there's an angle there, a subconscious element he's been saying. Maybe that's what the agent really wants, is for somebody to defy him for once and give him a good run. I don't know. I think that's something that just came up in my head.
Mm-hmm.
But it could have been an angle they could have played.
Mm-hmm.
But That being said, the dynamic of the thought processes that Mal has in his head are, you know, should you defy the government? You know, you lost this war fair and square. You admitted, you surrendered, and then that's it. We let you go. You should live in our world as honestly as you can. Mm-hmm. And not make waves, because you owe us one.
Well, you know, it's based on my understanding of the universe of Firefly, is that these people initially went out there to colonize and terraform whatever they could, and you know, I would assume that was done by contract. So anything that they did wasn't ultimately theirs.
Hmm.
You know, so you went out. The government put you out there to do the job. And when the job was done, you just said no?
Well, sort of. You know, there's always complications to these things when you set a contract that is so far back in time and so far back in physical space. The dispute was that, yeah, of course they'd set up contracts. You're here to colonize planets for us.
Mm.
For everybody.
Yeah.
They send you guys out first, and then once they did that, They didn't stop with this group of planets. They went on to another neighboring system.
What's going on in the universe is the Earth is dying?
Dying
or dead?
Overpopulated?
Yeah, there's
any number of reasons.
I mean, these guys are doing a very important job, and, you know, I think it's very, greedy of them to say, okay, well, now we were sent out here with best intentions for all of us, and now you're gonna have to fight us for it. Now we're basically being set up as kings of our own planets and stuff like that.
Well, sort of. I mean, you know, it's one of those natural things that would happen over time. Is what, even if they colonize, like say you come to our solar system and you get all 9 planets all colonized,
mm-hmm.
and there's the ability to move and go to this new area that was discovered after this is all done. That's natural progression. It's just they forced the hand out of greed.
Mm-hmm.
Enough wasn't enough for these guys. A whole brand new planet untapped and basically for the taking, all these riches and resources.
Yeah, you know, that's colonization for you.
Yeah, and essentially without having to fire a shot.
Mm-hmm.
There was no need for that.
Yeah, it was just show up.
There's no aliens, no indigenous life.
No.
They brought animals along with them, and pretty much just created new Earths.
Mm-hmm.
Atmospheres, gravity, as close as they could make it. But no, there was no conflict, and then the independents just get all uppity. It's not like there wasn't enough space to do stuff. Because they talk about some of these planets having populations of like 20, 30 million people.
Mm.
And full-size planets, like Earth-like planets.
Mm.
There's a lot of elbow room, let's just say that.
Well, you know, I can't argue on behalf of the independents.
Maybe, well, that was for the Alliance.
Maybe you can, because I don't have any arguments to support what they've done or what they're doing.
Mm. From my understanding, a big problem with the Alliance was the broad brushstrokes in which they painted essentially a new galaxy.
Mm.
Using not necessarily, what's the word I'm looking for? They're attacking indiscriminately. It's causing a lot of collateral damage to human lives.
Mm.
And they're using too firm of a hand when trying to bring people back into the fold. And it never struck me like there was a need for anything like that. But beyond that, that's pretty much the only fault I can attribute to the Alliance. They were the masterminds of this big thing, and it worked.
Yeah, you know, Mal has a line in this this movie that well, it's just like a general belief that the biggest crime that you can commit is telling someone what to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's worse than murder. Possibly narcotics dealing, possibly slave dealing, possibly, well, a whole slew of criminal activities, but you, heaven forbid, you can't tell someone what to do, because that is the highest thing, the highest wrong. I just don't hold to that, you know.
Well, that's one of those things, and until it's something that's taken away, it's hard to say. But you know, I can see your point of view that there are some immediately worse things than that.
Mm-hmm. And it's not like people are telling Mal what to do. Like, yeah. On the independent side, you know, Fanti and Mingo, you know, they're afraid of failing on this job right at the start of the movie for them.
Yeah, no matter what, we got to eat, so we've got to get money, and mm-hmm. you know, we have to buy food with this money. So you're already in the system.
Yeah, you know, it's just a different master.
Yeah, if anything, I find it extremely surprising that there's a lot of fans that can identify with the brown coats because they themselves are a part of the alliance. You work a job, you get a paycheck.
Mm.
You know, you're right in the middle of it. You're the guys that Mal doesn't like.
Mm.
Essentially, I guess maybe mountain men would be
maybe
as close as you could get, but
yeah.
Even then, it's a disconnect. You really have to stretch your own morals to get behind Malcolm in a lot of ways. Or at the very least, his brown coat ideals.
Yeah.
But the war is long gone, and he's just people now.
Yeah.
And at his heart, he just wants a family. Like, he lost his family before he joined up.
Mm.
And now that he has a family, there's one problem still sticking around that keeps getting him into trouble. And he wants to do what he can to get out of it.
Mm.
With his little loss of life to his family as it can, like his adopted crew is basically his livelihood now, his life. So I can see that side of it, but the way that he keeps connecting back to his brown coat roots,
it always keeps rearing its head.
Yeah, and you think after the war he'd be the one guy that'd be real happy, you know?
Well, he volunteered.
Yeah, he volunteered.
It was personal for him and.
Yeah, I
think he might say that he knows the war is over. I don't think the war will ever be over in his heart.
Yeah, he keeps doing things to thumb his nose at the Alliance. But you know, that's the cowboy thing. You wouldn't have a cowboy show if there wasn't an outlaw.
Mm-hmm.
Watching a bunch of farmers is a hard thing to sit down for a couple hours to do, even if it's in space.
With spaceships in space.
Space farmers.
I don't know. I saw The Good Earth. That was a hell of a movie.
The Good Earth? You mean the one in China?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a good movie, but, you know, that had conflict and intrigue that was also made a lot of sense. But, you know, I don't know. I don't know where I ultimately sit with this movie other than the fact that I really like it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you say anything bad about Joss Whedon's writing, you pretty much just get, oh, you're so wrong about it. But in essence, the characters of the Independents are really quite villainous.
Yes.
And it's...
This crew is the exception.
Yeah, the crew is the exception. But even then, they've obviously done some stuff to get one up on a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he's not Han Solo.
Well, you know, Han Solo killed a man in a bar.
Yeah, he's...
Killed him because his crime boss hired a goon to gun him down, basically, or shake him up for the credits, you know.
Yeah, and when you live a life like that, the moral high ground, very shaky.
Yeah. Like, what I take out of this movie is, basically, it doesn't matter where you stand, because, you know, it's all the same system, you know.
It's all the same system, and it's one of those things I always thought about was, even if you're an outlaw, you still believe in the system because you're an outlaw, because you prey on that.
Mm-hmm.
The true person that wants to disassociates.
Mm.
And if you have a spaceship, you have the ability to do that pretty easily.
Yeah, you can go.
So, those points get even more relevant the crazier the situation is.
Mm.
But my takeaway from the movie is, and it's the theme that I drew from the movie the most is always about love.
Mm.
And You always think of it's going to be like, oh, you got to fight for your true love and stuff like that. No, it's pretty pedestrian level love.
Mm-hmm.
I love my friend. I love my job. I love my ship. Very simple things.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem in the movie asks him to ask the harder questions about what he truly cares and loves.
Yeah, what do you devote yourself to? What are you willing to
put
everything on the line for? Because it's been a long time. since someone asked this crew to do that.
Yeah, a long time, and some of them maybe have never even had a question asked that that strongly and openly of them. Mm-hmm. Some of them are just new to the whole concept of intergalactic travel. So, in the end, yeah, it's asking questions of yourself and what are you willing to do. And I think that's a compelling piece of writing. But it does have its faults. Overall, I'd have to say I would like to see a sequel, but part of me knows it's never coming.
Yes.
Probably not. With the duck lips. Probably not, but I'm all right if that's the case. You know, as a fan of the show, I fought alongside a lot of people to get it either brought back onto the air.
Mm-hmm.
I never expected anything would ever work from that, because nothing ever does, really.
Mm-hmm.
I bought so many copies of Firefly and Serenity to give out to friends and whatnot over the years that, you know, it'd be hard for me to admit this wasn't one of my favorite things, but it does have its problems. But you're allowed to love things with problems. That's kind of what I do. Duck lips. Seriously. What is that? Simpsons character over here.
I agree with a lot of what he said. It's a good universe. It's a good movie, but it's not nearly as one-sided as you think it is. No. Or as Joss would portray it. You know.
No, when the villain can make such a strong case, and the only reason that the Alliance didn't win out is that he lost the fight. Mm-hmm. When it comes down to a fist fight, the reasons on both sides are pretty
close.
Pretty strong, yeah.
Yeah.
So, in the end, it's a great movie to sit down if you need something a little heavier than most of your sci-fi fare.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's funnier than most of your sci-fi fare.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of great dialogue. I will never knock down Whedon's writing and timing for getting you to laugh at strange things.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, it deserves a look. I'd recommend going back as far as watching Firefly. It's not a long series, you know.
No.
13 episodes. You can get it fairly cheap at a lot of stores. It's on Netflix now. But yeah, after a couple weekends, you'll engross yourself in a universe that's going to be hard to put out of your head. And hard not to use to compare to other sci-fi stories.
Right.
And I think that's pretty much where I stand completely with the whole series.
Right.
It's one of the most valuable pieces of treasure you'll ever have in your chest.